Five, four, three, two, one. Good afternoon and welcome, everyone. Sorry, we're a little bit delayed. We have some technical difficulties that we've rectified. This is the executive committee meeting of January the 10th. I'm Regional Council Bill McLean. I will be chairing this meeting. And first order of business, roll call, Madam Clerk.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I can certify the attendance of all members of council and they are all participating electronically.
Very much. Are there any disclosures of interest? None being noted. We have no delegates. The first matter for consideration is Director of Communication Service Report CS0122. Moved by Brenner. Councilor Butt, seconded by
Brenner.
Pickles. This is the Community Association lease agreement between 856 Pickering Kingsman Royal Canadian Air Cadet Squadron. Any discussion? There being none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Carried.
Move 4.2, Brenner.
Next order of business is 4.2, which is the Director of Engineering Services Report 0122, and this deals with the Road Refreshment Bay West Park, Lake Ontario Shoreline. Moved by Councilor Brenner, seconded by Councilor Ash. Councilor Brenner as a mover.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It pretty well speaks for itself. Perhaps maybe if staff could just clarify a little bit in terms of what they would see as the timelines once this is ratified by council regarding the engaging the services of TRCA that enables us to go ahead as a sole source purchase. For you, perhaps through to Richard.
Yes, thank you for the question, Councillor Brenner, and through the chair to you. We have been dealing with TRCA on this project for a number of years, as they are the owner of the lands and also the regulatory authority for all works to be done on the lands as well as within Lake Ontario shoreline. They have approached us and indicated that they would be very interested in doing the shoreline restoration work. As the report indicates, they had a lot of experience with this, not only in Pickering, but also in Toronto and other areas in the jurisdiction. They can mobilize quite quickly. If this is approved by council on the 24th, they are ready, willing, and able to come in early February this year and do this work within an 8-month period with minimal disturbance to the area. The access point will be off of Beach Point Promenade, just east of the three residences on the south side of that road. So they don't have to drive a lot along the Beach Point Promenade. They expect to be in and out within 8 weeks and expecting and hoping for a very good project.
Thank you. I want to thank our staff. This is something that we've been talking about for a while. And to be clear, the area for restoration, as we've heard from our director, is on the west side of the spit currently that we're talking about on that shoreline. And it's long time coming and certainly appreciated. And the timelines are very impressive in terms of to be in and out during the winter months to minimize environmental impacts. Mr. Chairman, thank you very much for allowing me to comment on it.
Councilor Pickles.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm just very supportive of the project. And, you know, I'm down there a lot. I've run into Councilor Ash walking his dog, and I know Councilor Brenner's down there quite a bit too. The only question I would have or suggestion, and maybe the ward councillors have already suggested this, but can we put up some sort of descriptive sign so people, when they start to see vehicles coming and going and doing work, they'll know what's up so that questions don't start coming up on social media as to what's happening, what's being built, what's going on, all that sort of stuff. Would we be putting up some sort of descriptive billboard anyway?
Through the chair to Councillor Pickles, within the proposal from TRCA, signage is not included, but we are carrying a contingency within this project that we would hopefully be able to use for signage. We would have to get a bit of a jump start. So if we get executive committee approval today, maybe we can get a jump start on the signage. It would probably take a few weeks for something to be put together and be placed, but I think we can get that done, if not by the first day of commencement of the project, certainly within the first week.
I appreciate it. It just may save us all a lot of inquiries. So just a suggestion. Thank you, Mr. Holbert.
Absolutely.
Mr. Chairman, I had one other question. I'm sorry, I did forget to ask our director, if I may, unless I don't want to cut anybody off.
I didn't see anybody else's hands. Go ahead. Go ahead, Chris, Councillor.
Thank you. Sorry about that. And I do apologize. And thank you for the latitude. Richard, when you were answering Councillor Pickle's question regarding the signage and so on, and I think you also, when you answered my question, you identified the area that they were going to do. The trucks that will be accessing the shoreline, can you give me the route again, where those trucks are going to be going and how they're going to get to the shoreline for the restoration work and the equipment, obviously?
Sure. Through the chair to Councillor Brenner, they would have to come down West Shore Boulevard, whether they come from the 401 or from Bailey or both. That's a possibility. They'll come down to the bottom of West Shore Boulevard, go east on Beach Point Promenade. And if committee members would like to take a look at page 25 of the agenda, there is a small map. The yellow areas indicate the actual access point from Beach Point Promenade onto the site. And the area circled in kind of yellowish color indicates the work area. And the staging area is surrounding the area where the access is that has the arrows on. So it's only about maybe a quarter of the way into Beach Point Promenade, just east of the three residences.
So the trucks, they don't, to access Richard, they don't go beyond the gate that's closed right now. Is that everything is in on the west side of the gate, or do they get onto the east side of the gate?
Through the chair to Councillor Brenner, all work is on the west side of the turning circle, west side of the gate. So on page 24, there indicates a small area of work just south of the turning circle. That's the armor stone wall that needs to be constructed. We're not anticipating that trucks would have to drive all the way along Beach Point Promenade to drop off materials, but we have to work out those details with the TRCA. But we're expecting most of the trucks to go in at that point shown on page 24.
I mean, I'll be honest, I had a vested interest in asking that question, especially as it pertains to the unopened road on the east side of that gate, but that's for another purpose. Thank you, and I appreciate the clarification.
Anything else? I just got a comment to compliment Councillor Ash and Councillor Brenner, especially as the ward councillors, for the work they've done on this particular project, as well as Councillor O'Connell, who was here before. The amount of time, effort, and consultation they put in, not only the staff, but also with the community on changing this particular part of Pickering that is really a destination place. And all members of council go there. It's not just Councillor Pickles and Ash and Brenner. I take my grandkids down there all the time, and it's a real nice, pleasurable walk where you can interact with residents from Pickering. And so it's a great improvement, and I'm looking forward to moving the funds from this side of the bay to the other side of the bay in 2022-2023. So thank you very much. Call a question, unless there's other questions. All in favor?
Aye.
That's carried. Next item is from the Director of Finance and Treasurer.
Move 4.3.
4.3, move that by Councillor Butt.
Second it.
By Councillor Brenner. This is a recommendation for the interim property tax levy to be adopted for all realty property classes for 2022. This is a standard policy that we have at the beginning of the year to make sure we have funds to pay for things until we have a budget ratified. Any questions on this, Councillor Butt?
Thank you, Mr. Chair, for allowing me this. Just a question for the treasurer. With the pandemic here now, obviously we don't have people coming in to pay the taxes. it directly. The question of the treasurer is that at what percentage do we have the pre-authorization residents sign up?
Well, the city's pre-authorized payment plan is a very good plan for the simple reason residents are permitted to pay their property taxes over a 12-month period. So compared to the installment-based, where property taxes are due in February, April, June, and September, this plan takes the current property taxes and allocates them over 12 months. And so therefore, it's better for the residents, for cash flow management, and for any other financial purposes. And it is a very popular plan. The plan we do offer, we debit the individual's bank account either on the 1st, the 8th, or the 16th of each month. And the plan is flexible so the individuals can sign up. And I currently have 13,000 residents on the plan. So obviously that's the true test of the popularity of the plan. So I encourage all residents who are watching the council meeting, if you haven't yet signed up for our pre-authorized payment plan, please do so.
Mr. Treasurer, I guess this also applies to the business accounts?
Yes, the commercial and industrial commercial and businesses can also apply for the pre-authorized payment plan.
Okay, very well. Thank you, Mr. Treasurer. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Councilor Brenner.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Through you to the director. Stan, the question that I'm interested in knowing about is, if we were to take a snapshot of a year ago, a couple of things are parallel. We were in a type of a lockdown a year ago going into the interim tax billing period. And I know I asked a question back then and you were able to respond to it. A year later, we're into a situation again with COVID-19 and some, you know, different types of lockdowns or closures, and may not just be in Pickering, obviously, that I'm referring to, because Pickering taxpayers work in other municipalities in our geographic region. Do we have an idea in terms of if we were looking at the interim tax bill that came due in February a year ago, what at that moment in time, how many of, you know, had fallen behind in arrears for that interim period when it came up? I know we recovered it and we did a good job working with people, and I want to compliment you because you've still been working with a lot of businesses and residents that have fallen behind in terms of repayment plans, and I really commend you and compliment you for that. But I'm curious as to the situation a year ago, and if we were to look at it, how did we fare out at the end of the due date for the very first interim billing in terms of arrears at that point in time, percentage wise?
If I recall correctly, we haven't seen any increase or spike, but Councillor, you raised a good point. And well, what I will undertake to do is, after the February due date, I'll issue a memo or to members of council comparing the February 22 interim due date with the February 2021, comparing the amount of taxpayers outstanding, if you understand what I'm saying. And I think that will then provide us a good guideline or indication to see if the city has to do what it did last year to innovate or create a new program to provide some flexibility for our taxpayers.
That's excellent. Thank you, Stan. I appreciate that. And having those comparisons certainly will enable us to look at where the hardship may have been, and if it's the same, is it more, is it less, and how we fared out in the end. Thank you very much.
Hopefully Omicron will be gone and it'll be easier to work with.
Well, I think we said that last year about Delta, so I'm not making that prediction.
That's correct.
Thank you very much, Stan.
I'll think positive. It'll be gone, Stan. Anybody else on this item? Call the question. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Move the next item, Chair.
Next item of business, moved by Councillor Pickle, seconded by Councillor Butt. This is the Director of Finance and Treasurer's report, and it's a request to award a contract to NTT Data Business Solutions, Inc. for an SAP application management services. It's to replace our way antique, outdated system that we have for treasure. As a mover, Councillor Pickles?
I'm good with and support the report.
Any other comments? Being none, call the question. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, that's carried. The next one is a Director of Operations Report, OPS 0122, moved by Councillor Brenner, seconded by Councillor Ash. This is the mechanical harvesting. Your hand was up, wasn't it, Kevin, or were you scratching your head? This is the mechanical harvesting for the weeds in Frenchman's Bay. And as the mover, Councillor Brenner.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I'm glad to see that this is back up on the budget again this year, and certainly I'm excited about the fact that I'm sure we'll have support for it. I know we had challenges last year, and those challenges caused an unfortunate delay, which meant that we were removing the weeds or pulling the weeds or cutting the weeds just as we were getting into the end of August into September. So what I'd like to do through you, Mr. Chairman, is to ask our director, Brian Duffield, or Richard Holborn, whichever one is best equipped, to talk a little bit about the challenges we did face last year and what was going on behind the scenes that made it very difficult for us, and what we're hoping to accomplish this year by getting at this hopefully a lot earlier, and maybe his thoughts on that, as well as the importance of some of the partnerships, which certainly involve the Frenchman's Bay Yacht Club, who have had some serious problems because of the bay. And I know, Mr. Chairman, you're chair of PARA, and I know that they had problems getting the boat in and out as well. So perhaps for you to Brian, maybe to start, if you could provide a little bit of an overview about the challenges, what our learnings were from last year, so that we're able to get in front of it this year, and where you see this heading, and also who the partners are that we're going to be working with. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Brian?
Thank you. Through the chair to Councillor Brenner. If I can give you a quick overview of where we are and what we achieved last year. As everybody probably knows, the Eurasian water milfoil weed is an invasive species that has taken over a lot of these types of shallow warm water inlets and choking out the native species. It's only going to continue to get worse as we get climate change and the conditions for the early growth in the spring gives them a long season for this weed to keep adding across the entire bay. And as everybody has been down there has seen, the extent of it is quite a lot more than it has been in previous years. Obviously, it is really impacting small craft recreation on the bay, whether it's paddle boarders, kayakers, dragon boats, having a real problem getting into the bay and getting the level of recreation that they've been used to in previous years. The Pickering Harbour Company, that is the owner of almost two-thirds of the bay, do some weed control, particularly from the yacht club through to the entrance. They cut a channel every year, but that really doesn't help for the recreation small craft users in the rest of the bay. So we decided to do this on instruction from council, the pilot project last year. Unfortunately, it was late starting because of the requirement for us to use Pickering Harbour Company's vendor of record to do the cutting. We couldn't use our own company to do the cutting. We had to use theirs. We're allowed to cut between July and September in the bay. It's a warm water fish habitat, and so there is a restriction on the number of months that you can cut. And unfortunately, we weren't able to start cutting until very late in August, and the majority of the cutting was in September, and in fact went into October. As a result, we weren't able during the pilot project to get a sense of how much of the regrowth would come back from the initial cuts. If we had been cutting in July, we would have been able to see what sort of regrowth we would get and see whether we would have to repeat the cutting once, twice, possibly even three times to maintain a weed-free area for recreational boat users. So unfortunately, that did not happen. And also there were some equipment challenges. The equipment couldn't always get to the very shallow parts of the bay, and that may be the specific equipment that they use. The other restriction that happened that we weren't anticipating for last year is we were expecting to be able to remove the weed from the bay and transport it away. The equipment that the Pickering Harbour Company uses emacerates the weed as it cuts it and puts it back into the bay. So I think that we made a good start last year to have a look at the feasibility and perhaps a proof of concept of doing a weed harvesting in the bay. But unfortunately, because of the challenges that we had with the late start, the type of equipment, the breakdowns that we had, it really didn't tell us if this was something that we can pursue on an annual basis. And the recommendation in the report is to come back and do another pilot project this year, starting in July.
Thank you, Brian. Subsequent question, and you may have touched on it. Would it be fair to say that number one, one of the other driving factors is that the Pickering, that Frenchman's Bay, the majority of that bay is owned by the Pickering Harbor Company, as you allude to, and that the question of control means that anything we do must be done with the approval of the Pickering Harbor Company. Am I correct?
Yes, you are. Under their charter of 1853, they have the rights to the bay and all work that goes on. So it's like us going on to somebody else's private property. So we have to work with them. There are a number of other partners that have had discussions with us and would like to collaborate with us in this, because there is a number of interested parties, whether they are recreational user groups, TRCA, the Yacht Club. I believe there are a number of other organizations that we can capture into a complete Frenchman's Bay management program that can explore the best way to cut this on an annual basis and get everybody's use, whether it's the Yacht Club, whether it's what the work boats from the marina need, and our recreational small craft users as well.
And just on what you were saying, Brian, through you, Mr. Chairman, by virtue of the charter that Pickering Harbor Company has to the bay, there is some level of responsibility that they would have to keep the channel open, which is their responsibility as the owner of the bay area, if I'm correct. And also, I believe, a pathway for the boats to get in and out, which is tied to that. What we're looking at in terms of our funding that we're talking about today is to supplement what Pickering Harbor Company is required to do based on their charter and expand on it for the recreational uses that you've alluded to, whether it's dragon boaters, whether it's paddlers, whether it's rowboaters, whether it's canoe. It's to supplement so that we have a safe recreational space within the Bay Area that the public can enjoy. Would that be a fair summary of it, Brian?
Yeah, through the chair to Councillor Brenner, that is correct. The pilot project and anything ongoing would not be to replace the obligations that the Harbour Company have to other users, such as the Yacht Club. This is really focused on expanding the area that is cut to particularly get the small craft water users a better use of the bay.
Thank you, Brian. Mr. Chairman, so obviously as the mover and in support of this, a few comments that I do have is that we have been working very, very closely, and I know that you, through the chair of PERA, were also part of it, along with yourself and the late Councillor Cumming, in terms of the impact it has on on all sides of the bay, along with myself and also Councillor Ash, because of its involvement on our side of the bay. What we have done, and I want to comment on that, is that the bringing the players to the table has been critical, because these are the partners. And as recent as last week, I had the opportunity to have a virtual meeting with the new Commodore and Vice Commodore of the Frenchman's Bay Yacht Club, to just have them catch up on the different initiatives that we've been taking on the bay, but most importantly, on this particular matter to keep the boats so they can get in and out. And they've agreed to meet with us, being the councillors from the two wards, along with our staff of resource, to stay on top of developments and what's happening on the bay. We had a great meeting that was facilitated, that was set up through Councillor Pickles, with the Dragon Boaters, I believe that they're called. They're going to be at that table as well. It is not the same as a discussion table in terms of the entering into agreements with the Pickering Harbor Company, with who's paying what, but it is a jumping off point to make sure that we are talking about the recreational uses on the bay, people that use the bay for recreational purposes, and so that everybody has the same information and no misinformation. And those are going to be a monthly meetings that we're having with our partners, or community partners. And I see that as very positive. And I want to congratulate the new Commodore and Vice Commodore. As a matter of fact, I also want to say this is the first time in the history of the Frenchman's Bay Yacht Club that they have a female Commodore and a female chair at the same time heading up and leading the yacht club. And I was very impressed when they were talking to me about that and their willingness to work with the city of Pickering. With relationship to the actual partnering, the project that we're talking about today, I'm comfortable with the fact that staff have committed to bringing to the table those parties that have a direct interest on the bay, that in fact have responsibilities on the bay, which does include the Frenchman Bay Yacht Club, some of the other marinas, the city of Pickering, because we do have sections on the bay, and most definitely the Pickering, the Frenchman Bay Yacht Club, to be part of this with the Frenchman's Bay, not just the Frenchman's Bay Yacht Club, but also the marinas, and that's Pickering Harbor. So I'm looking forward to us going forward and this time getting in front of the July deadline. I know it was not our fault, and I'm hoping that this time that we're able to move forward, but also through you to our staff, would appreciate if they could provide us with maybe a mid-seasonal update regarding this. So since we do know, and I'm not going to move any amendments, but they can take it as friendly direction if that's okay through you, Mr. Chairman, and through our CAO. And that friendly direction would be that, assuming this passes now, when it's going to pass and be ratified by council, that we get an update probably around May on the status of where we're at. And then we get another, and that'll tell us if we're good to go in time for July. And then perhaps if we can get another update on status, probably towards the end of July, which tells us if we're good to go for, if necessary, with the second cut and harvest or whatever is going to happen in August. So we're really looking at a check-in update May, a check-in update in July. Brian, would that be, can you take that as a friendly direction rather than having an amendment?
Now, through the chair to Councillor Brenner, yes, we'd be happy to provide that.
Thank you very much, and thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Sorry, Mr. Chair, did you recognize me? I didn't quite hear it all.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, thank you. You know, I think we've all been down on the bay and out of the docks and boats and seen how terrible the weeds are down there. So of course I'll be supporting this motion, and hopefully we have a better year of clearing the weeds than we than we did last year. Myself and Councillor Cumming were out on the weed harvester, I'll call it a boat, I guess, just off of Bruce Hanscom Park, watching it work one day. And back to Mr. Duffield, you had specifically mentioned, and we had seen at the time, that this cuts the weeds, it basically sort of chews them up and spits them back out again. Did we not have enough time, and I know it was a very brief season, to really ascertain whether that's the best mechanical method? Some people say seeds go back out or that it grows back quickly. Do we have any idea how effective it is, or we just simply didn't have enough experience last year to be able to determine?
Through the chair to Councillor Pickles. No, we did observe the way that they macerated the weed when they pulled it out, and it looks like it really does liquidize the material. However, we're probably not equipped to understand the biology of this plant and know whether it is actually preventing it from seeding. This is a pretty vigorous plant, and we were told just today, actually, we were meeting with TRCA's biologist, and they said that any part of this plant that is cut can repropagate itself and grow again. So it's a very vigorous plant. We would probably have to do some research to know that the maceration of it actually works better than pulling the weed out and getting rid of it. Of course, there are challenges taking the weed out and getting rid of it, because you have to dry it, you have to ship it away from site, you need quite a bit of land to be able to dry it out, and there's always the question of the smell of the drying weed as well.
Okay, thank you, and hopefully we'll get more
information.
Councillor Brenner had noted in his remarks that we had recently met with the Pickering Dragon boaters and canoeists, and that was myself, Councillor Brenner, and Councillor McLean was also on that call. And they're very concerned about the weeds in the bay. I note when I was out on the harvesting boat that they use a GPS system to keep the boat going where it's supposed to go and harvesting the weed. And that we had helped map that out in advance as to what areas were going to be cleared, and I guess in what order. Do groups like the Dragon Boat Group and the canoeists help us determine those maps and the timing? Like, I don't know if we want to get over to Bruce Hanscom first or other areas first, depending on who's using the bay at what time. But so what I'm asking is, I guess with respect to the route and timetable of the harvesting, are we having groups sort of input what part of the bays need to be cleared at what times of the year would be best?
Through the chair to Councillor Pickles, the $50,000 for the pilot project only gives us the ability to cut about 2 hectares of weed. So we had to focus, and what we decided to do last year for the pilot project was to select 2 areas, one on the east side of the bay and one on the west side of the bay, one off Progress and one off Bruce Hanscom, running north-south, which should be accessible from shore entry in those 2 parks to get into an area that was cleared. So we focused on those 2 areas, and as you quite rightly say, the boat was given those coordinates and they recorded that through their GPS data when they were cutting it to verify that they'd cut the areas that we had requested. They were not able to get in as tight to the shore as we had hoped, and that was because of the depth of the cutting head that it needs to be to operate, and obstructions which are on the bay that can affect the cutting heads and can actually damage them if they get too shallow.
Okay, as long as we're consulting those groups or have an idea where those users are going to be, and hopefully we have more time to do the harvesting this year, therefore we get to more of those areas and see a better result in clearing the weeds out of the parts of the bay that are used by our user groups. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. A question to Brian. Brian, you mentioned earlier that apparently in a pilot program, the weed was pulled out. And I also, I think you said, can be very cumbersome and also smelly. In your pilot program that you did, what did we do with the weed that one once it was pulled out?
Through the chair to Councillor Butt, yes, it was using the equipment that Pickering Harbour Company uses on an annual basis. They emacerate it, which is to chop it up and put it back into the water. So they do not remove it from the water. It's mashed up and put back into the water.
So with this practice here now, when you mash it up, put it back into the waters. I mean, I just wonder if enough research has been put into its place. It's like, you know, I have weed on my lawn and I cut it and put it back on my lawn again. I'm not sure if I'm clearly understanding the system in terms of cutting and putting back in back into the waters, though.
And it's a very good point. I don't think that we are the experts to understand the biology of this plant. And if we are in fact making it worse by putting it back into the bay. So I think part of the pilot project this year is to consider whether we should be looking at the removal of the weed from the bay. That has, from an ongoing point of view, that has a dramatic change in the cost of weed harvesting in the bay if we actually pull it out and remove it from the bay. And of course we are limited at the moment to the equipment that Pickering Harbour Company has a contract with to perform the harvest in the bay, and the equipment that they do use is the one that deposits it back into the bay.
Yeah. The other, have you approached our farmers in terms of saying we can recycle this weed and probably use it as a fertilizer, put it to good use?
Through the chair to Councillor Butt. Of course, that would be an ideal situation, be able to actually find an end use for this material. The challenges are you do need quite a large area on the shore to be able to take the weed out, to spread it out to dry it, because you cannot transport it wet. You're paying a lot of money to actually move water around if you try to ship it wet. The customers that would think about receiving this would prefer it to be dry when they get it. And so it's quite labor intensive to not only to spread it out, but you have to turn it over to get it to dry before you can take it away. And anyone who's been to the ocean and has smelt the seaweed on the shoreline, it can get offensive. And we understand that this milfoil can be the same way. So there are some challenges in preparing the material for reuse, for agricultural use, or for fertilizer.
Okay, so is this in your pilot program approach in terms of handling this, though, looking into more?
For this year, we would not be intending to do any bulk preparation of materials to be sold on, but I think we do need to examine that and be able to put it in the year-end report that we bring back to council.
Okay, now here, help me out with this, some clarification here. You stated that in the Charter 1853, the PSC is a private property, correct?
Correct.
And so we are actually going in a private property, cleaning the weed for them. Help me to understand that. Like, I mean, what are the benefits for us?
Through the chair to council, but I would request that our City Solicitor can give you some information on that particular point.
If that's all right with the chair, I'm happy to offer a few comments that address Councillor Butt's question. Councillor Butt, the Pickering Harbour Company is in a somewhat unique position of having assumed ownership rights over the lion's share of Frenchman's Bay, based on a charter that predates Confederation. It's from around 1853. So it's older than our nation and older than any constitutional framework that governs us and our laws. That makes the analysis of their rights and our rights and the public interest a little bit more complicated, a lot more complicated, honestly. And we are examining that now. Just to have a fuller understanding of the right relationship between Pickering Harbour Company and the city and all stakeholders to the Bay. I can offer, this is not strictly a legal point, but I think it addresses your question in part. I can offer the fact that there are public interests, recreational, social, that are served by making Frenchman's Bay viable for watercraft, small watercraft, and general recreational use and enjoyment. So the public interest, I think, is clear and is shared by our community and the Dragon Boaters and other organizations. The key is to make sure that our collaboration with Pickering Harbor Company and the TRCA and anybody else that we identify as a stakeholder, that that collaboration is based on sound principles and a proper understanding of what the responsibilities of each party are. So that's a little bit of a long-winded answer, but I think it addresses your question about why we're on private property in the first place.
Okay. All right. So if I can come back to Brian, thank you. Appreciate that, Mr. Johnny. You apparently stated that we have 2 hectares and we're spending $50,000. So how much total weed hectare land do we have now?
The total size of the bay. I do not have that, but I can find out what the total area of the bay is. I don't have that information available, okay. But I will give it. It represents the acreage that we've cut, the 2 hectares, is a very, very small proportion of the entire surface area of the bay. And there are areas at the north end of the bay, which are protected environmentally, that we would never cut. So we would never be intending to cut the entire bay. There's an area which would represent somewhere between 25 and 30% of the entire bay that would be cut. And some of that is the obligation of PHC to do anyway, as they do to clear their channels for the yacht club to get out to the harbor entrance. So we would never be intending to cut the entire bay for recreational use with the environmental sensitivity of northern end of the bay.
Okay. And my last question, Mr. Chair, if I may, please. Thank you. The cost now for $50,000, we're asking now, is this inclusive with our partners, or is this the city cost of share?
Through the chair to Councillor Butt, that's the cost to do the additional cutting for small craft use, not for the work that they already do.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Brian. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Anybody else? There'd be none. I have a few questions there. In regards to this, I know when Councillor Brenner and Ash and I met with the stakeholders quite some time ago, we discussed such things as harvesting, and at that particular time it seemed like a good idea. We're going to have a pilot program to see how that could work out. We also had at that particular time a spot where we had picked it where it could dry. We also had an end user that would have taken it. Farmers use this dried up weed as a fertilizer, but unfortunately that never came to fruition. We're sort of like the rock between the hard place here. We need this bay cleaned for our users. We certainly need it cleaned for Dragon Boaters as well as the Yacht Club. Certainly need it clear for para, where we couldn't get out of there last year because our props kept on getting caught up in the weeds. So that was a hazard from a boating perspective and also from a life and safety perspective. So, this is one way to start to address this problem. And, the Pickering Harbor Company is no stranger to the bay. They're no stranger to the weeds. They're no stranger to their responsibility. It's my position that any homeowner would be responsible for clearing the weeds and making the property safe for cells, but other people that might be accessing it. I don't know why Pickering Harbor Company is not taking this responsibility on for themselves. And I realize that they are doing partial, but anytime we talk to them, they'll waive this charter, like it's a Magna Carta, that stay off my land, it's up to us to do this, it's up to us to rectify things. But they're certainly not doing it. We've had to push them for years to dredge that channel before we put $8 million into it. And I just don't think it's fair to the taxpayers that they should be taking on this responsibility. I will be supporting this because, you know, we have to start working somehow, some way to keep this bit clear. My question to staff is, years ago, and I think it might have been around 2005 or so, yeah, putting money aside to look at bug or weevil or whatever to take over this weed. Do we have any information on how that worked? What went wrong? Is that something that's still in the books? Because to cut it twice a year, it's almost like the definition of insanity. We're doing the same thing over and over with expecting different results, but getting the same results. So have you looked into any other ways that we could eradicate these weeds for good, as opposed to pumping $50,000, $100,000 a year into putting a Band-Aid on it?
Yes. I understand that in the past there has been some chemical control of the weeds, but I understand as a freshwater habitat that chemical control of the weeds is not permitted. And I'm not aware of any other solution. The bay itself is very shallow, and anything less than 10 feet will allow the light to get down to the bottom of the bay and will encourage weed growth. So if it was a deep water bay in excess of 10 feet, and I do not believe that the Ministry of Environment would give permission to do wholesale dredging throughout there to be able to deepen it beyond that 10 feet. So apart from those, I'm not aware of any other measures that you can do other than to keep harvesting the weed.
I'm not talking about dredging, and, you know, I'm not talking about using chemicals. I think this might have been called a boll weevil or some type of insect or whatever that was introduced to the day. Maybe you can check on that for when this comes back, just to get more information on that. I know it didn't work. I don't know whether it didn't work because it wasn't properly instituted, or if this process is still around, or still something that is being used by other municipalities with the same problem, because these weeds are everywhere. Could you do that?
Chair McLean, I can provide a little bit of information with respect to the weevil program that was done in the early 2000s. I was around for that. What the city of Pickering did was contribute financially to this program, I believe was undertaken by the Frenchman's Bay Yacht Club at the time. And we did this over 2 years. We provided a financial contribution. Weevils were like a bug, if you will, that was introduced into the Frenchman's Bay to basically eat away at the milfoil weed. And it was, as you said, not very successful. After 2 years, the Frenchman's Bay Yacht Club basically abandoned the project because they were not getting any results, or at least not to the level that they expected. So I don't believe that's a viable option anymore.
Okay, Richard, it wasn't because of the end user or the user that didn't do it properly. It was just because that particular process did not give us the results that were expected.
Yeah, that's correct. Yeah.
Now, Pickering Harbor Company on page 58 they put the blame for this directly on our shoulders. In the second paragraph, it says the weed infestation is a direct result of stormwater and catchment practices managed by the city of Pickering over several decades, much of which is well documented through evidence-based academic research, studies, and media reports. Is that correct? And I know that the runoff from the 401 was always a concern back in the early 2000s when this was looked at. So is this something that is still a problem, that our runoff, our stormwater, our catchment practices, have they improved at all in the last 20 years? Or are we still contributing to this problem at the Bay?
I can provide a comment on that if you're willing to listen.
I'm always willing to listen to you, Richard.
I just didn't want to jump right in, you know, assume that I could start talking.
So. I don't always agree with you, but I'm always willing to listen.
There you go. So I wouldn't wholeheartedly agree with that one line comment that was made. I think you have to go back several years to realize that the development of Pickering and pretty well all municipalities, when they occurred in the 60s and the 70s and even into the early 80s, there really was not a lot of regard to stormwater management other than from a flooding perspective and maybe an erosion control perspective, but not so much for water quality and also increase of flows. Those were not the mandates, the things that were looked at the time. So a lot of Pickering was developed under that regime where really you built storm sewers to get them to the creeks, get the water to the creek, and then the creek to the bay and the bay to the lake, and just avoid flooding. That's what you did. So that is a common practice amongst a lot of municipalities in those decades, if you will. Have we learned from that? Absolutely. The city of Pickering did the Frenchman's Bay Stormwater Management Master Plan in 2009. That was endorsed by council, came up with a lot of programs, policies, and projects that would help with quality of stormwater. But those projects were not all able to be undertaken. One, because of cost. I believe the value at the time was over $50 million, but also because some of the solutions were on lands that were not under the ownership or control of the city of Pickering. So it was a best efforts idea of, you know, where we can put stormwater management facilities for quality control, where we can put oil grit separators within the storm sewer systems, try to collect this material before it gets down to Frenchman's Bay. And some of those projects have been implemented and some of them are still underway as we speak today. We have budget approval for a few of them and we're going ahead with them as well. But a lot of the concern with milfoil weed or any other vegetation is really nutrient loading. So it's things like phosphorus and phosphates. And that comes from a lot of sources. It can come from precipitation. It can come from groundwater, come from septic systems. It can come from fertilizer on grass. A lot of residents used to do that. Now we are into more environmentally friendly ones, and also from farm, what they called poor agricultural practices with the fertilizers that are put on farm fields. So a lot of that is not within the control of the city of Pickering. And that is also a contributor to the weevils. Other things are such as low rainfall, warmer temperatures, increased sunlight, that causes weed growth as well. So to hang everything onto that one statement, I don't think is fair. There are a lot of contributors to poor water quality, and this is over decades and decades, in Frenchman's Bay as well as weed growth.
That was Pickering Harbor Company making that statement.
Correct.
Our buildings that not our buildings, but new construction such as San Francisco by the Bay or any of these other ones, each one of those condos that goes in, they all have the separation to filter runoff water before it goes to any downstream locations.
To the chair, each site is looked at individually through its development process. They all have to look at water quantity control to avoid flooding and erosion. They don't always have the available means within their site to do water quality. So they can provide a cash in lieu for that. But quite often these sites will have oil grit separators within their own site before they discharge into our storm sewer. And that'll collect a lot of the sediments and any oils that would be going into Frenchman's Bay, if that watershed feeds into Frenchman's Bay. Most of them do, but not all of them.
And the stormwater retention ponds that some places have filters that before it gets down to the bay. Pickering Harbor Company says it's essential to cut at least 160 plus acres of the bay to provide a meaningful improvement in access for recreational usage. They say that eliminating the weed infestation through weed harvesting methods will cost the city of Pickering $1.9 million per year, plus per year in perpetuity. Is that, did I read that wrong, or what is that?
To the chair, I think they've taken the 160 acres of the entire bay and multiplied that out to say that it could potentially cost $1.9 million a year if you de-weeded the entire bay. Obviously, that is not practical, and there are restrictions on parts of the bay that we can't do, particularly the environmentally sensitive part of the north of it. But yeah, I think you're correct that they are saying $1.9 million plus if you did the entire bay multiple times per season.
Okay, and I know we're going to hear back from our solicitor in regards to property rights, property standards. When might that report be coming back, Mr. Bajoni?
Councillor, that report is underway, and I am conferring with staff that were present at the time the work was undertaken back in the 80s. It has not yet been contemplated to take the form of a report to council, so I'm in the CAO's hands in that regard. My intent is to provide the legal advice and to take it from there, which would certainly be done if you wish it presented to council, will certainly be done in an in-camera meeting. Timing-wise, it is difficult to pin down a date, but I am hoping to have preliminary direction before May, so that I can plug that into Brian Duffield's May update.
Mr. Bajoni, I brought this issue up many, many months ago when we were looking at our property standards bylaw, and you assured me at that particular time that this would be something that we would be looking at the same time that our property standards bylaw was upgraded. I'm a little disappointed that we haven't really addressed this, as it's sort of, in my mind, might have been put on the shelf a bit. I don't know whether you need a motion from council to do this, but I think it's most important that this item of property standards, whether it's above water or under the water, be addressed as far as accountability goes. So, could I give some direction here now? Or would you like that, or would you like it in a motion?
Councillor, I have already been tasked by the Chief Administrative Officer with this work. It's underway, as I say. It was never keyed to preparation of the new property standards bylaw, but rather was part of the project concerning the milfoil weeds and how to address that problem in the bay. So that is a project that has taken a few different twists and turns in terms of who's involved and how it's administered. I've now been tasked by the CAO with doing that work, and I'm doing it. So maybe offer direction, but none is required for the work to be completed.
Maybe I could ask the CAO when we expect to see something on this report of who does what, who's responsible for what in the bay.
So to provide a summary to council, really what staff are looking to do is achieve two things. In the immediate term, obviously we provided a post-project report on our efforts in 2021, expressing some of the limitations of its findings. but letting council know that we'll be including monies in the 2022 budget to repeat the pilot project in more strategic areas and measuring its success. So we've got an immediate term goal of doing this in 2022. The other is a short-term approach or measure, which is to really bring together the three owners of the bay, TRCA, the city, and the Harbor Company, to understand exactly what we're dealing with in the bay. And we'll certainly have the biologist from TRCA there, because from what we learned today, the plant, the weed, is very invasive. It is not something we're ever going to eliminate completely. So we've got to develop a strategy to maintain the bay with these weeds. How are we going to do that? And those efforts are really going to be, on the city's perspective, we need to have the information from Paul to be able to guide those discussions, because obviously that maintenance program needs to include all partners, but the extent to which each partner is responsible to contribute, either financially or in terms of staff resources, should be guided by the responsibilities under the charter or by our property standards. So the information that Paul's putting together is going to be very useful to staff as we have those discussions and lay out a plan for the bay moving forward. Obviously, we want to have that work done throughout the course of this spring and the summer so that we have a plan moving forward for next year. I don't have an exact date because it really relies on the three partners being really willing to come together and have those discussions and finding meaningful solutions.
Okay, I'm not going to beat this weed to the into the weeds, but I think it's important that we know what Pickering Harbor Company's responsibility is for their lands. And it's my opinion, and I'm not the legal advisor here, that their lands, their responsibility to clear their weeds. Now, I think from what I understand also that the TRC is responsible for the north end. That's their part, and down by Bruce Hancombe Park and all that. The city of Pickering is basically the harbor entrance, is it not? Is it more to that than what I'm saying as far as our...
I believe our property is more located to the north of the bay.
Where?
Not at the mouth of the bay. The mouth of the bay and that large swath is the Harbor Company.
Which is TRCA and us, that's co-proprietors of it, I guess.
The north end.
Yes. Okay, thank you very much. Just one other thing I'm going to close off with. Krasno Creek, if we look at the map on page 69, say, or even 68, that's not Harbor Company land, the creek. It's under TRC control, is it not? First, I imagine it is. So you look at the creek as it comes from Krasno Creek, comes down, it goes under Sandy Beach Road, and it runs along in behind Parkham Road and comes back out at the square. That particular tributary is quite important because it brings water from the north down, the stormwater. We spent several million dollars on culverts and all that to prevent the flooding. We'd have flooding there three times a year to Willowside and Streamside Courts. So we've improved the drains coming north into that bay. But the problem there also is the invasive weeds are there as well, which really restricts paddle boaters or canoers from going from Sandy Beach Road up through that marsh area to the bay. I think that's something there that we could probably do a pilot project on, where we take those weeds out right at the roots and see how that works on that particular scale. And that may be something we could transform over to a bigger scale. So that's my thought on that. I don't know whether you have any comments on that, Marissa. Don't worry about comment. I'm going to make a motion in other business about that. That's all I have on this particular item. Is there anybody else that has any comments? I'll call the question. All in favor?
Aye.
That's carried. That being done, other business. Councilor Brenner?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Got a couple of items, but first, did I happen to see that Councilor Butts got a new pet?
No, I actually had this almost 9-10 years now.
Never saw it before. I'm just commenting that now that Councilor Butt is filled the shoes of Councilor Cumming, all of a sudden there's a cat that appeared on his screen. And I wanted to compliment him and say how excited I am that he's now part of the family of almost every member of council. I think you're the only one, Councilor McLean, that doesn't have, but you do have pet fish. So anyway, thank you. But I do have some items. Mr. Chairman, we've heard the term over and over again that the city of Pickering strives or is a world-class city. That is a term that we all embrace, and it's part of how we see ourselves in terms of competitiveness on the market, to stand out above the rest. And there is no question that we are, in fact, and can be a world-class city. But being a world-class city, Mr. Chairman, is not just about what we do in the areas of development and attracting businesses. And that's a discussion for a whole different day. But being a world-class city is also about what we do in terms of coming up with solutions in terms of the residents' needs on a regular basis. What I've tried to do, Mr. Chairman, is identify, and I don't want to get into the discussion today, but it'll lead to a numbers of notices of motion in areas that we as a city, regardless of whose authority it is, need to be part of the ongoing creating solutions to some of these challenges. And I don't think anyone would expect a world-class city to do anything but less. As a result, Mr. Chairman, I wish to give notice that it is my intention to bring forward two notices of motion pertaining to homelessness initiatives. One having to do with potential emergency beds, and a second one having to do with potentially a warming station and a hub. I put these motions forward today only procedurally because I'm hoping, and Councillor Pickles has reached out to me, and I want to thank him as the Vice Chair of Health and Social Services. We are looking at perhaps doing a think tank later this week to address these solutions, but if need be, and if it requires some direction from council to whatever level of government, I want to make sure I have that placeholder in place for the council meeting of January the 24th. So that's to say that I'm giving notice for two motions as I've outlined. A second area that is also that we all are aware of and has to do with recreational use. And in particular, we've had lots of discussions regarding recreational use on the Bay Area. It is not a secret. All members of council were copied. We have been all seen and inundated with comments on our social media accounts on the desire that our Bay be much more open, our Frenchman's Bay Area and trail system during the winter months. And again, that means looking at different creative ways, world-class ways, to be able to accommodate the needs of our shareholders, and that's the people of Pickering. To that regard, Mr. Chairman, I'm also giving notice of potential of two notices of motion pertaining to winter maintenance. One has to do with winter maintenance and potentially the winterization of washrooms on both the Frenchman's Bay West and Frenchman's Bay East. So that'll be two notices of motion. The second one within those notice of motion has to do with skating on the bay. And that notice of motion is going to be geared to looking at ways in which we can try and maximize Frenchman's Bay as a place for winter recreation. Don't want to get into a debate today, but I ask our staff and members of council, take a look at Scugog, a rural community, and what they are doing and how they are maximizing the lake in terms of winter activity. We're not Scugog, we are a world-class city. And this is not saying negative about Scugog or any of the rural communities, but if they can find ways of maximizing winterization, so can we. The other thing I would also give notice, so this will be the fifth notice of motion, and this has to do with our waterfront parking and a way to address some of the issues that we are experiencing using our overflow parking lot at the Alex Robertson Park and ways in which we can maximize that to be able to reduce some of the parking stresses both on the east side of the bay and the west side of the bay. So, Mr. Chairman, those are five notices of motion for the January 24th council meeting. And it, I believe, can assist us going forward into budget discussions, but more important, look at long-term and short-term ways of being able to address the needs of our community the way that I know that we can as a world-class city. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Anybody else? I have a couple of items. I mentioned the Krosno Creek, and if you see the map, you can see that this is a tributary that leads from Sandy Beach Road all the way over to Liverpool Road. That's a nice passive area where people do canoe and do use it not only in the summertime, but also in the wintertime where they skate on frozen water. The problem with the skating now, from the resident I've spoken to recently, is that the weeds are coming through the ice. So I'm going to do a notice of motion in regards to Krosno Creek and look at some of the weed problem. The other item I have is I'm going to give a notice. Brampton came up with a unique idea where they have a little contest amongst their neighbors for backyard ice rinks. And it's really taken off in Brampton and it's created a real community cohesion there where residents are really getting into outdoor skating rinks, and that's good for everybody, not only in the COVID, but even in the non-COVID time. So They have a nice program there where residents will do an outdoor rink and be judged by the city, and then awards will be given out, much like our community in Blooms, but only in the wintertime. And it certainly does give recognition to people for their the way that they've put the rinks in, but also gives them an idea to bring other neighbors into their backyards for ice skating, little hockey games. So I don't know. I'm going to give notice to bring this before council on the January meeting. I don't know whether I'll talk to staff in the meantime to see if this is something that we could do without a notice of motion, but I'll give the notice now anyways. The other one, the outdoor rinks that we've proposed, we've got the ones that are being proposed, people are really excited that we're finally, as a city, addressing outdoor skating rinks. It's the only time I wish we had colder weather where we could actually get these in operation for a longer period of time. But people are really excited by it, and I think it's a good investment for us as a council into the community. The cost of one of these rinks is about $4,000 for material, plus our labor from our staff, which are, our staff have really taken this to issue. I was at the Dunbar Forest Park a couple times this weekend talking to the staff as they were making the rink, and they were really excited by about these rinks and putting their heart and soul in. So it's a really great project for the residents. Parkham Road, which I just talked about, that runs behind Krosno Creek. Talked to the residents there many times about an outdoor rink, and it was something that we could never really get our hands or get staff to look at this. But I think now is a great opportunity for us to expand to one more rink. $4,000 or $5,000. I know the community down up by this. They're hoping that it's through. So I'm going to give notice motion to include an outdoor rink at Parkham. I think a fantastic location. Got flat land there, parking around the corner where people could park the cars and go to the park if the skating rink thing. So that's the third notice of motion I'm going to sign. Thank you very much. Is there anybody else that has something? Okay, motion to adjourn.
Move it.
Councillor Butt, seconded by Councillor Ash. All in favor?
Aye.
So we're going to sign off. We're going to go into an in-camera meeting. 5 minutes. Thank you.